We've got a robot arm down the hall that we use to do plant reconstruction. Maybe that's for another video.
Well, should we go and see what it... Can we look at it, or...?
We might be able to look at it. It'll be messy because, you know, it's a PhD student. Of course, the door also might be locked because he might have gone to the gym. He spends a lot of time in the gym. Here we go. So this is, in some sense, in the prototype stage. So, you know, lots of cables around. But you can see it's basically taking pictures of the plant. And actually, in fact, the camera here is static, and at the moment, the turntable is moving. And this is our tame PhD student, Jonathan. The way that this works is that the camera will try and move to get the best possible view of... Shall I just move out the way of this?
Well, let's just see what that says. Do not touch any of the equipment.
Yeah, I come here and move it about when he's not here just to annoy him. But what it will do is it will move to try and get the best view of the plant it can. Some plants are different sizes, so you're going to have to move backwards to get them into shot. Some of them are smaller with more intricate leaves, and you've got to try and move in closer. So this is still a work in progress, but it's something we're working towards. Space carving is one of the things we're examining here, but we're obviously doing a lot of other stereo matching and multi-view stereo as well. We talked about stereo matching, right? So we've got some cameras and we've calibrated them. We know where they are in three dimensions. And then we can use feature correspondence between different images to work out how far away something is, or lots of things in the scene. And we can begin to build up a disparity map. Now, there are lots of ways of doing this. Today we're going to talk about one that's slightly unusual, that does see quite a lot of use in research, in academia, and in plant science and things like that, where I obviously do a bit of work. And that's called space carving. Space carving is the idea of starting up with, in a sense, a big lump of clay, working out where you know your object is not, and cutting that clay away until you get something that kind of resembles what your object is supposed to be. Except it's based only on what you can see in two-dimensional images. So, I mean, a good example would be, if I show you this, right, what's that? Okay, that's a serious, it's not a trick question.
Okay, well, that's obviously a mug. It's a cylinder with some...
It is a mug, right? A cylinder with a handle on it, which is, I don't know what the shape of that is, right? But the thing is, you can't actually be sure, okay? You've only got one camera, you're looking at it from this direction. This mug could go off for 1 meter backwards into this wall, and you wouldn't absolutely be sure that it didn't do that, apart from your intuition about what it is, okay? And the fact that you're human, you know it's a mug.
And that's, sorry, just because I'm handheld and not on a tripod, I can move side to side.
You can move side to side, okay? So one of the ways that we work out what shape an object is truly is we move around it and see it from other angles, okay? Or we rotate the object and find out it isn't in fact a meter long because I would have just hit myself in the head, okay? But the point is, until we see it from a different angle, we can't be absolutely sure. Now, on a computer, that's more true even, because they can't intuit anything. We show them this and they say, well, it's a square box with a little circle on the end of it. And that's all they can tell us. Okay, they can't tell us what shape it is. They can't tell us that it's hollow or anything else. Because how would they know? Right? How would they know that it isn't longer this way? Okay, unless we start to build in some sort of rules. So what space carving does is look at this mug and try and carve a piece of clay in that shape. Okay, but under the assumption that it could go back here. Right? Then we turn it and go, oh, it doesn't. And cut that bit off. And then we turn it again and we cut that bit off. And we keep doing this until we cut off as much as we can. The more views we get, the better the result. So if I draw a picture, and I'll show you. So let's start with this Rubik's Cube, which after comments on the last video I solved so that people wouldn't crab at me. Anyway, right, so this to my eye is a cube. Okay, we're ignoring the color and the divots in it for now. But if I look at it from this angle, it's kind of a sort of, I'm not sure what shape that is, some kind of
diamondy,
squarey, someone in the comments will know what shape that is and they can say, right? I don't, okay? The point is, I don't know that it's a cube based only on that view. It's only when I rotate it a lot of times that I get to feel what it is. So from the side, what we might have is we might have an image. Now, we're assuming as well, actually, that we can segment this.
What do you mean by segmented?
So work out where in the which pixels in our image are our object and which bits are the background. Okay. So this room is not ideal for this. Okay. First of all, because this is quite a tricky one to segment because it's different colours, but also because there's books and shelves and weird computer code and things around the place that are distracting. So often when you're using space carving, you will put a big black background or a big white background at the back, so that you're just not making life too difficult for yourself for no reason other than because you like paint, right?
So this is a bit like in the movies when they use a green screen.
It's exactly like that. So the green screen obviously lets you replace the backdrop, But if you made the green screen have different colours on it, all you'd be doing is making your life more difficult. So I take a picture of this from the side with a blank background, and my stereo algorithm tells me that it's kind of that shape. I, in my mind, have an idea of some kind of big volume of voxels. Voxels are quite popular these days due to a certain piece of software called Minecraft. But voxels have been around for a while. A voxel is basically a 3D pixel. Now, in Minecraft, you can think of each square of land or air or sea or whatever you've got as being a voxel. And then obviously the rules of the game change depending on what things are in different blocks. In my work, the voxels are basically the same. It's just that we don't tend to have stone and lava and things, okay? Yeah, I mean, I'd like to, but unfortunately no one's paying me to do that. So what we have is we have a huge block of 3D pixels. Okay, something like this, right? I'm not gonna finish the last side, because people don't wanna watch me just drawing lines all day. The point is that this voxel down here will either have something in it or it won't, okay? Now, there are algorithms that have degrees of they can sort things like distances to the nearest surface and things like this. There are more complicated versions of this, but we'll just pretend that isn't a thing for now.
So just to kind of get this absolutely clear, that's not the Rubik's Cube you've drawn then. Is that like a 3D canvas or
that? Yeah, that's exactly what it is. It's a big 3D image. At some point, we will hope our cube will be in it, but it isn't currently, okay? Our cube will be somewhere in the middle of this, and some of these will disappear. So what we do is we project this image, which let's imagine is intersecting this directly, right? So it's not at a funny angle for now, okay? It's coming this way. And we say that this pixel here is background, okay? So this row of pixels here are not of interest to us, and we remove them. So this gets a little bit smaller. This one, same again. This one, same again.
So you're carving them off?
We're carving them off, exactly, right? And in actual fact, what we're doing is just setting them to zero, okay, or something similar. I mean, actually, these things are stored usually in an acceleration structure like an octree or something like that, that lets us do this a little bit more elegantly.
That's got to be a different video.
Yeah, let's leave that for a different video. Basically, it would be unusual to store this just as a huge block of contiguous memory, just because it just takes up a lot of RAM, especially if you're trying to do this at a high resolution. So we get rid of this one, we get rid of this one, but these ones in the middle, they're part of our object. So we know maybe we flag this one up and this one and this one and this one. Is that kind of the same shape? Maybe, yeah, ish, right? This is not a very high resolution voxel volume. The point remains, okay? So we've carved this off. Now what you then get is basically a sort of triangular-y cylinder in this direction, okay? So it's not anywhere near our Rubik's Cube yet. So what we then do is we rotate this, or we move either the object or the camera, and we intersect again. And then we move it again, and we intersect again. And we keep chipping away at these things, and they fall off, and then we get left with something that hopefully resembles our Rubik's Cube. Now, this isn't actually always the case. If I draw a picture from top down, right, so if we're now looking at our Rubik's Cube from above with a camera at the side. So here's my camera, right, and here's my Rubik's Cube. Most cameras are not orthographic, which means that they don't look in parallel to the scene, they look at an angle. They're conical shape. The projection matrices are conical. So this actually sort of squishes all of this scene in here like this. Okay, which actually means that the cube is slightly distorted. This is why you get things like barrel distortion and things. Well, it's one of the reasons you do. So the problem is that this camera sees an image that looks like that, okay? A square box inside some background, right? So it carves away, but it can't carve away parallel to these edges because it can't see parallel to the edges. So actually it carves away like this. So not only do we not know what's in here, but we also don't know what's here and what's here. Now, if I bring in another camera, my paper's getting quite thick, quite full of stuff. So here's another camera here. This is gonna come in like this. And so now my object is, well, it's sort of this bit. Okay, so now my object is that shape, which is still doesn't bear any resemblance to our cube at all. In the literature, this is called the photo hull, or the photo consistency hull. So this is basically our best guess at what the object is based on the evidence we've seen so far. And it's interesting how far away that is from the object. We, as humans, in two views, have sized this up straight away. Oh, it's a Rubik's Cube, yeah? One view would do it for me. But for a computer, two views, not anywhere near enough. So we add another one from here, and we go from the top, and we cut them out. And we gradually improve on our model. But we're never gonna completely improve on it, not with perspective projection cameras, which are all cameras, basically. I mean, if you wanna buy an orthographic lens, it'll cost you somewhere around £20,000, and it will capture a piece of image about this big. Like, you know, you'll get 30 centimeters of shot. They're quite cool, though. Anyway, we keep carving away at this, and what we'll end up with is something that looks nearly like a cube. So we probably maybe a bit of extra there, and a bit of extra there and there, but we'll get it. We're getting there. Okay. Now, some objects obviously are more amenable to this than others, but the more images we get, the better it is. There's no depth involved here at all. Okay. We're not worrying about depth. There are people who are using RGBD cameras, and that would help this.
So that's red, green, and blue, and depth.
Yep, that's right. So Kinect, for example, or the Matrix camera that we talked about a few videos ago. So that has depth information added to its RGB, which just gives you more information on what's going on. That, combined with this, is quite a powerful tool. But in this case, I can't afford a Matrix camera right now, so we'll just use a normal camera, and we carve away at this. Now, the problem is that this, to the camera now, is a circle and looks exactly the same as that. Okay, when you haven't got depth information, we know it's hollow, but the camera doesn't. So the best we're going to get with space carving is something that looks like this, but it's completely full. Okay, which is just sort of a block, because how could we possibly carve into this when we can't see through it? And that's one of the problems in the literature. For example, if you're reconstructing plants, a rice plant that has very flat leaves will work fine, because you can carve away sort of parallel to the surface of a leaf. I mean, actually, there's a lot of other problems. Rice plants are very, very thin. But if you use like a tomato plant that's got a big curved leaf surface, you end up with this big block of leaf where you don't really know where the leaf surface is, because it's somewhere in that block and we couldn't carve away anymore. And that's a bit of a problem. So the plant that you were looking at a minute ago on the turntable is kind of one of our test plants. It's actually quite hard because it's got some leaves coming out the side, but really it's just a big mass in the middle, which space carving, of course, is not, it's not capable of dealing with.
It's not really suited for it.
It's not, right? It's suited for dealing with things that are quite sparse or simple primitives. Now, in our case, we're using space carving to work out where the camera should be, and then we're using more detailed 3D methods to do actual surface reconstruction. So it's just a means to an end. But it gives you a proof of concept how it works. So this is the actual model. You can see we found all the leaves. They're not hugely high resolution because we didn't attempt to space carve this at high resolution. You can imagine also there's quite a memory overhead the higher resolution you go. And you can also see the middle of this plant is kind of useless, because it's just very busy. From a silhouette, you can't gain a lot of information about what shape it is.
Yeah, it's a little bit like Lego, a Lego model of it, or a Minecraft model of it, isn't it? Yeah.
So the detail's really on the edges, you know, and then in the middle, it's not a lot you can do. It depends on the object you're taking. Much younger plants obviously work quite well. So this is a picture of our mug. There we go. So let's just move it into the middle a bit. There we are. You can see the mug there. It's circular-ish. It's kind of a cylinder. And it's got a handle on it, okay? That's as good as we can get from that kind of resolution of camera that's that far away from the mug. You can see that there's still some voxels that need to be carved away that haven't, and that might just be because of the exact angle of cameras that we used. The more angles you have, the more you carve away, the closer your object gets to being the real object. But it's never going to get right quite there. And this is completely solid, okay? It's not hollow, because how would we know what's hollow and what's not? Okay, and finally, our Rubik's Cube, which is almost, in some sense, the worst of our reconstructions, because it's cube-ish, right? But it's not particularly a cube. I mean, that's cube, kind of, right? But this is the same shape that I was pointing towards on my paper, which is that we can't really carve away these bits very accurately. 90-degree sides like this do not lend themselves well to space carving. For an example of one that does work really, really well, so in Wageningen, they're distinguishing between the size of tomato seedlings in a factory. So they're growing tomato seedlings for sending out to the greenhouses. Those of you that don't know, the Netherlands is big on greenhouses. Okay, there's loads of them. I've flown over them, they're massive. And they plant a bunch of tomato seedlings, and then they very quickly classify them into different classes and send them off to different places, depending on whether they're big or small or have you. And this is done incredibly quickly. Space carving can do what 3D reconstruction takes quite a long time to do in fractions of a second. That's one of its benefits. It's very, very quick.
So it's rough and ready, but it's quick.
Rough and ready.
Or quick and dirty.
Yeah, right. So they've got 15 cameras, all with gigabit network connections, streaming this data off. And it's really impressive. It all happening in real time. So there are uses for space carving. It's just another interesting approach to 3D reconstruction. I only asked him last night on a whim, can you just, you know, do this mug for me? And so it's you know, it's small, it's low resolution, but it gives you an idea of what space carving does.
Based in what?
Wageningen. You have to get the correctly. It's in the Netherlands.
Okay,
and it's a place full of plant scientists and other researchers. They do other things too. But we work with them quite closely on a number of projects.